Yeah, so I suppose I should introduce myself. My name is Mei, and I'm supervised by Kathleen Hugh and also by Michelle DeCourcy with the School of Education. And I've been working and researching in a very multicultural high school, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that context. So this is really just... It started as a bit of a sideline to my main findings and my main study, but of course translanguaging is a topic of great interest in across sort of the applied linguistics and educational linguistics fields. So I thought there was maybe something worthwhile that I could say about what students are doing in this context. So I'll tell you a little bit about the study and the context. I'll show you an overview of multilingual practice that I've observed in this school, talk a bit about translanguaging, although by no means am I any kind of expert when it comes to the theory on that, show you some examples of translanguaging from the school, a very brief discussion around some... I didn't really know what word to use here. Problems probably isn't the right one, but we'll stick with that for the moment. A little bit about pedagogy and curriculum that's going on in the school, and maybe some time for discussion. So, as I mentioned, it's an ethnographic case study of a single school. That school is a high school close to the city. At the time of the data collection, it was about 600 students, all girls, and year 8 to 12. And I guess sometimes when you're interstate or international, have to sort of explain how high schools work in South Australia. It's a little bit different to other places. This is an overview of the languages spoken at home by the students at the time that the data was collected. You'll notice that English is about 52% there, so slightly more than half the students at that time spoke English at home, but now it's swung the other way, so about 47-48% speak English at home. And there are the languages in the mix change every year, so if you were to see the graph this year, it would look a little bit different. But as I'm an EAL teacher, it's a great place to work. We're always busy. So I collected data from students and staff in the school. That included work samples from students, which incorporated multilingual resources, by which I mean the students' own multilingual repertoires, not so much external resources, though you'll see some examples of those. And they were from a Year 10 unit of work, which included research into linguistic practices, and also from the research project, which you may know is a compulsory part of SACE Stage 2. There were also focus group discussions, 7 groups incorporating 17 students, and there was a questionnaire conducted with staff, and 35 staff responded to that, and as well as interviews with 10 staff. So that kept me busy for a while. That was good fun. And this is what I found out. So, I don't know, this again was something I did to aid my thinking around what kind of multilingual practice is going on in the school. So that's certainly from a student's, in terms of student practice. And then the questions I asked around teachers and other staff was, how do teachers respond to this? What place is multilingual practice given in the school? And especially, you know, you may be familiar with high schools in Australia, but we tend to operate under an assumption that it's an English monolingual environment, which it may be at some level, you know, official levels or dominant practice of the teachers, but certainly at the level of student practice, it's quite different. So I can give you a bit of a zoom in here, I think, that we can see that, you know, underneath the practice of the whole school, there's particular multilingual practice of the students, which extends outside of the school environment. And then in the school environment, when they're using their languages to support learning. There's individual practices and collaborative practices. And this includes here some examples of translanguaging practice, which I'll focus on today. But we also have the staff responses, which might reject or accept or engage student multilingual repertoires in different ways.
Sorry.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm glad you could join us.
Sorry.
Okay, so translanguaging. This is a concept, a word even, that's been receiving quite a lot of attention over recent years in literature related to multilingual education in particular. And I think there's a lot to be said about translanguaging. And the first question that I thought of when I came across this word is, well, why do we need another word for this? You know, multilingualism, plurilingualism, code switching, all of these things. We talk about them already, so what's the point of that? Well, I can give you a very brief potted history, but again, that disclaimer that I'm no expert. So originally the term was developed in 1994 by Ken Williams to describe what was a purposeful pedagogy that Welsh language teachers were using to apply English and Welsh in the classroom, and they would use one language for reception and one for production. And I will not at this point attempt to pronounce the Welsh. But over time, and particularly probably over the last 10 to 15 years, the use of the term has expanded or been expanded. And I would put it simply to say that translanguaging describes the act of crossing boundaries between languages. So there are a lot of sort of well-established concepts that could be included in translanguaging, such as listed there, translating, interpreting, code mixing, code switching, code meshing, hybrid languages. And it can bring together phonological, lexical, syntactic or textual features of different languages, and it could be both cognitive or communicative process. So generally I'd say I'm not a fan of proliferation of jargon. I mean, that's the same word that we use for nuclear weapons. So I'm inclined to question the purpose of additional term like translanguaging, and certainly in the beginning I did question that. But in this case, we can identify a couple of important purposes. And one is it's an umbrella term for a range of practices, so in a practical sense, that's something useful. But probably more importantly is that it unhitches these practices from the negative connotations around mixing languages that have sort of developed in linguistics and language education around ideas of linguistic purity or protection of languages. So I think that's probably where the value lies in discussing ideas like this. So my next point that I've made to myself is that translanguaging can signify something of an ideological standpoint towards languages. So when languaging is used as a verb, it can indicate an understanding that language is a dynamic practice and process, and it's implemented with agency by people. So that's in contrast to language being a predefined body of knowledge or a set of rules that can be correct or incorrect. And translanguaging does problematise the idea of separate languages or borders between languages, but of course it can't completely negate that idea, because in a way it relies on the idea that there are borders to be crossed. So that's kind of an ongoing concept that I'm still thinking about. But like I said, this is really my understanding of translanguaging, and I wanted to try and define these concepts for myself so that I could analyse the findings of my research through this lens of translanguaging. So the question is, why would I do that? What am I looking for if I'm applying a translanguaging perspective to the data that I collected? So in my analysis of data, I wanted to look at that information from three different perspectives: power, policy, and practice. and from a broad social position to institutional practice and then down into the classroom or interpersonal practice. And so translanguaging, given, I suppose, the focus on translanguaging in the field at the moment, was quite appealing as a lens for that classroom or individual or interpersonal level. So I guess I asked myself a few questions in applying this lens. So I wanted to see what was the translanguaging perspective, what could it show me about student practice, and in particular, you know, to what extent do students do this in the school? To what degree do those practices support learning? And in what ways is that learning, all those practices, supported by or hindered by what goes on in the context of the school, particularly perhaps what teachers do, but also other students, or indeed the multilingual students themselves. I also wondered whether there was anything new I could contribute to the discussion of translanguaging. Perhaps I could describe some new examples of translanguaging in different contexts, different purposes with particular features, or even in the, particularly in the electronic mode, because we're looking at a group of teenagers basically here. So it's a very common mode of communication. I wondered whether I could discern some purposes for specific translanguaging practices in relation to education. And whether there's anything that emerges from this that might be useful for teachers, coming, of course, from that teacher point of view. And then, of course, if I was so fortunate to be able to answer those questions, perhaps there might be something in there that's a little more generalisable across different educational contexts. Now, having asked those questions, I really don't know if I'm going to answer them to your satisfaction, but we'll see. So as I showed you earlier, but not so clearly, analysis of my data sort of brought me to categorise translanguaging practice like this. So I identified first that the translanguaging practice is always purposeful. So that related to social and academic purposes and examples of a range of modes. I also thought that translanguaging in these examples could often be playful. So students translanguage in ways that reflect or support their identities and their creativity. And then lastly, I observed that privacy was a really significant feature of translanguaging in this context. You know, given that it's a so-called monolingual English-speaking school, translanguaging may often be done in private, but could also provide privacy on different occasions. So to begin with, I'll talk about the first category, which is purposeful translanguaging. How are we going here? Still of interest? Okay. So just to outline here that we can talk a bit about social and academic purposes of translanguaging, and in sort of different modes, the interpersonal, the electronic, related to collaborative learning, but also private individual learning, and some examples of text, but also interestingly, maths arose as a context for translanguaging, and I'm not the first person to notice that. So socially, students use translanguaging interpersonally, face-to-face, and this is with friends, family, and members of their community. So these quotes come from the student focus groups, but also from students' language folios that they produced in their Year 10 work. So you can see here a range of social purposes, and I have a bit of an aversion to reading directly from the slides. You can all read that, I hope. But you can see that the students are explaining the really purposeful nature of that translanguaging or switching of the codes. And they might be translating in their families for a range of purposes, from very high-stakes social purposes like going to the doctor, to more interpersonal but equally important purposes in the home. We also see electronic examples of translanguaging, and don't worry if you don't get the chance to read this because it's here with visual support. So this was an example from a Year 10 student who surveyed her friends in Hong Kong and Australia about how they use Chinglish, which we recognise as a hybrid language of Chinese and English. And we see here that the majority of its use is, in fact, electronic through text messages. So I think that's something, you know, this student research has given us a bit of an insight into something that we may not otherwise see, and it suggests a direction for research that might be very interesting. And then this student investigated the use of different types of English as well as different languages in text messages. So she has noticed that in her friends' text messages, full English words, abbreviated English words, and their home language of Dari were used for different purposes within those text messages. So, you know, I think this not only shows us about translanguaging, but also shows us that high school students, in this example, but most likely students at different stages of schooling are certainly able to tell us a lot about what goes on with languages or what they do with languages inside and outside of school. So in school, there are a few different examples of where translanguaging might fit. So to start with collaboration, and I think that's probably fairly easy to imagine, that students use different languages from their repertoires to help each other learn or behave in a particular way in the classroom. So Selena reported that students would always ask each other, how do you say this word in English? But they're doing that asking in their home language, which in this case was Hazaragi. But in Selena's group of friends, she didn't only use English and Hazaragi. You can see in the second example, so this is Selena's a student of Afghan background who spent some time living and studying in Pakistan so that she could speak Urdu. And then when a student came from Gujarat in India, this student's first language was Gujarati, but she also knew Hindi. And because Hindi and Urdu were mutually comprehensible, these students chose that as their medium of communication, especially in the foundational stages of engaging in the school. So, I mean, this is incredibly complex practice, and I would observe that often students who are learning English don't get credit for the complexity of their linguistic practice. And then the last example is from Thelma, who is showing like that her multilingualism and her ability to translanguage is a resource that can support her monolingual peers. So when her peers were looking for particular vocabulary, she could think of a concept and translate that from Tamil into English to be able to support those students. So all of this kind of secret society business going on. Mm-hmm. And then we see, so those examples were collaborative between students, and we can see examples here of students using translanguaging more individually in a cognitive mode. Sanam explained that when she was studying her subjects, for example, biology, that she would, of course, be in an English medium classroom, but then take all of her information and her notes home and translate that into her language of Dari so that she could learn it again and make sure she understood as best she could, you know, strengthening her understanding. And then in Shania's case, she was a student who would use English as her primary language at school, but then if she got stuck, she knew she had another resource that she could refer to. So, and I think we can see here that really she's moving from the cognitive space to the metacognitive space, thinking about how she can cross those linguistic boundaries in order to support her learning. So it's very complex and, from my point of view, very impressive practice. So this is the examples of maths. And students reported that in that cognitive mode, switching from between languages and thinking about concepts between languages could help them both with the problem-solving aspects of maths and with the calculating aspects. So that's engaging not only their linguistic resources but also prior learning from other contexts. Each of these students had had fairly significant education in Hong Kong, India and China, and that included some maths learning. So again, this aspect of translanguaging has received a bit of attention, but it's probably worthy of more. Then we get to some more rich kind of data where we see that students translanguage as well when they're interacting with text, particularly with written text, but there are some examples of multimodal text. And you can probably imagine that film, television and music are also very commonly accessed text in a range of languages. And so we can see evidence here about note-taking or planning texts that need to be written eventually in English for school assessment, that those note-taking and planning stages involve translanguaging practices with the home language. And then I mentioned a research project earlier. So I have quite a few examples here which are just really interesting to look at about how students draw on external resources, sources of information that can support them in research, and then how they can apply their multilingual repertoires and their metalinguistic repertoires to transforming that information to something that's useful in the school context. So this is an example of a student from Rwanda who spoke amongst other languages, Kinyarwanda, Swahili and English. So she was researching the Rwandan genocide and came across a book that was written in Kinyarwanda. Now she found it very difficult to find translation tools from that language into English. So what she would do was read it in Kinyarwanda, translate it in her head to Swahili, type the Swahili into Google Translate, read the dodgy English that Google gave her, and then rewrite that into something more comprehensible for English for her notes, and then use that to synthesise into the final report. She did this. She went through the same process after interviewing a relative via Skype who was living in Rwanda. So she took a record of that interview and then went through the same translation process in order to produce notes for her research project folio that were useful for both her and her teacher. So, and one of the comments I could make is that this is a student who had been identified by various teachers in the school at being at high risk of not achieving her SAIS, of not achieving academically, yet we see here such complex problem-solving practice and linguistic practice, which I suppose we find is not really well accounted for when it comes to assessment. Here's another example. So this is Top. No longer in year 10, she was undertaking the research project, and we can see that she's translanguaging in her annotations in English about the Chinese text, and those annotations and the information served to help construct her final report, which was written in English. And we can also see aspects of the planning process that she undertook, and if you're familiar with the research project, students do get credit for their research process, so the folio. We just have to, I suppose the teachers marking this kind of work have to have a higher level of trust in their students because there's a certain amount of work that they may not be able to check or verify. But I think that the very sophisticated level of practice there is quite obvious. This is another example from top, and you can see in the bottom right corner, well, if you can read her writing, she says, I interview him in Cantonese, my mother language. This helped me to interview better as it is my most familiar language. I learnt to ask questions and tried to respond to his answers. So this is information from an interview that she's conducted in Cantonese and is not entirely translated into English, but notes taken in English from that and reflections written in English as well. But of course, had she not chosen to interview someone using her mother language, she wouldn't have had access to that information, which was about whether Hong Kong should use traditional or simplified Chinese characters in official documents. So this is the kind of question where really translanguaging is completely necessary. You couldn't ask, or you couldn't answer a question like that without applying those skills. This is another example. This is Sanam. She's our student who would study her biology in English and Dari. So she researched boat arrivals to Australia, and in doing so, she had access to primary sources whom she could interview in Dari and Hazaragi. Now she's explaining, well, she's showing here and explaining that because she was unable to type in Persian, she transliterated the Persian into English using the normal school computers and the English keyboard in order to contact her interviewee, explaining sort of the ethical aspects of an interview. And then she explains how, you know, she had to go through this very complex process in order to send questions to her interviewee, writing. She wasn't able to use the computer to type the questions and send them, so she wrote them, took a photo, sent the photo. He asked her questions, what did you mean? She texted him the answers, transliterating again into Dari. And then when she received the answers back, she translated them from Dari into English in order to use them for her final report. So there's a huge range of cross-linguistic skills here, as well as use of technology. So just regarding this idea of purposeful translanguaging, I think we can see that there's very purposeful pedagogical focus in the academic aspects of the translanguaging, but also clear purpose in connecting with particular individuals or communities in the social sphere. And, you know, it takes into account the particular resources that each person in that interaction has and trying to find the resources that overlap. So, and all of this was enacted by students completely independently of the teacher. And the academic outcomes, though, end up being monolingual English outcomes because that is what is mostly assessed. And these tasks particularly relate to the SACE, but probably across most school tasks, that's what you would find. But, you know, what you see at the end and the product that's seen in the end sort of hides all that translanguaging process that was used to get there. And, of course, the research here at UniSA is showing sort of a similar aspect of process. Now we can look at the playful side of translanguaging. And I actually really enjoy this, and I think you'll see why. So I've sort of categorised the playful aspect into translanguaging that connects students with culture, whether it's their family's culture or new cultures, having fun and expressing or practicing creativity. So this is some examples of cultural connection. The first example is like a connection to past or to historical culture in the family. The second one, joking, actually came out in my data as something really key to linguistic identity. So the ability to make jokes and understand jokes in the home language was something very important. But need be, students would try to explain them to their friends if they had to in English. And of course, connection to new culture. Selena was an Afghan student, Hazara student, connecting to Bollywood. I also saw a lot of examples of students keen to engage with Korean drama and music, Taiwanese, Chinese, all kinds of things. Like, these students are very highly inclined towards the multilingual. Translanguaging in itself could be something of a recreational activity. So the first student being bored in HASS, which is Humanities and Social Sciences, just in that particular class, she thought, well, I'll see if I can, you know, read this information in Tamil. So she got to Wikipedia in Tamil, and there it was. And she said she was reasonably successful. Like, she could read enough to be quite pleased with herself, so that's good. Ma Poi and Top are both from Hong Kong. So they speak Cantonese together, English together, and then just fun practicing their Mandarin. And of course, these are teenage girls, so annoying people is apparently fun, and something that students would report doing reasonably often. So there's a lot of entertainment to be had from translanguaging. And this is kind of an example from Top, so going back to her Year 10 language research. And she's just showing that, you know, there's a lot of communication in here that is expressing creativity and expressing personal connection and also making wordplay. And that's something that probably for these students is so much richer when it uses translanguaging as opposed to trying to do wordplay monolingually. I wish I could explain it to you. So another aspect of playfulness was creativity. So the use of hybrid languages from this example is explained here by Top. So, you know, it's not formal, there are no rules, we can have fun and do what we want. And also this idea, like, ridiculous or unnecessary use of language. So it's definitely a strong form of self-expression. So, you know, why is play important? I would argue that if it's not fun, they're not going to do it. So the playfulness in translanguaging makes it a sustainable practice, and it takes it beyond, you know, the social and academic purposes and makes it a more personal benefit. And Li Wei wrote about the idea of creativity, but I think this is a different way of talking about creativity, where he discussed when students make decisions or when young people make decisions about following or flouting rules of language. But I think this is going further than that and creating their own practice. So I think it's very positive to see that students in this context where translanguaging or multilingual practice might not be explicitly encouraged, they still enjoy a lot of what it has to offer. So the last aspect was about privacy in translanguaging. And I mentioned that these students translanguage for private purposes and in private modes. So they may want to hide what they're talking about or doing from other people, or it may be that we as researchers or teachers just don't have access to those modes where it's happening. So top here is explaining, again, the Chinglish. It's normal that you guys don't understand. This is not for you. This is for me and my friends. Priya gave a really interesting example. So she had quite a strong identity in the school as a leader and very outspoken student in her class. And when she found she didn't know how to thread the needle in the sewing machine, she didn't want everyone to know that. So she quietly asked her friend in Tamil, and no one needed to know. And then Shania talks about that private mode of the inner voice, and that there's a strong personal connection with their first language in that way. But a lot of, and of course I don't have examples of truly private practice. A lot of what happens we can't expect to see, especially as teachers. It's out of our sight, out of our hearing. It's happening in students' heads or between each other. And even when it's happening, I mean, I certainly don't understand many of the languages that my students speak. They might be writing their own notes, you know, translating words here and there, or texting, or even we have instant messaging at school, and I'm sure that they are using that in multiple languages as well. So I guess the question is, should translanguaging remain private? Why is it private? I think probably an easy response to this is to say it's not encouraged in schools. Students sometimes expect to get in trouble for using languages other than English in a school setting, and they certainly talked about that. Students have a very strong sense of which teachers or which classrooms they can use different languages in and which they can't. So in response to that, perhaps it's a natural response to keep this private, to keep it quiet. I think there is benefit to be had in making translanguaging practices more public, particularly, you know, in allowing teachers to recognise multilingual abilities and identities in a school, but also using translanguaging as a resource for learning. But at the same time, students have, of course, a right to private practice. So I suppose we might say, okay, at the moment, you know, it's all purposeful, it's largely private, and some of it's playful. But maybe we could try and just reduce that level of privacy a bit to bring it into the classroom more, perhaps. But I do want to say that I feel that the students have granted me a very privileged look into what really has been private practice. And I've been able to gain that information because the students themselves contributed their own research and their own reflection on that kind of practice. And I suppose there was a degree to which we had a level of mutual trust and understanding. So the advantages, well, there are advantages of being quite established as a teacher in a school and being a researcher at the same time. So there are some disadvantages, like just how busy it is. But I think that was a really privileged position for me to be able to be in at that time. And through that look, we were able to see, you know, we're not looking at just discrete examples of translanguaging practice. We're looking at how this is a part of students' lives across many different contexts for them. So not to say that translanguaging is amazing and perfect and everything's good. You can see here that there's a lot of sort of contestation or doubt around translanguaging, and these examples really speak to those ideas of linguistic purity and students' questions around whether it's okay to hybridise or to mix or to be inventive in different languages. There's a question from Zahira also about the practicality. Who's really going to understand her conversations where she's translanguaging three different languages in, you know, a single utterance, for example? So it's like anything really, you know, It's translanguaging, not only the word is contested, but its place in education, highly contested. And even, you know, the value versus the threat that it might pose to different languages in different contexts. Something to consider. But I did advertise that I'd talk a little bit about applications in schools. So this isn't actually part of what I'm focusing on in my thesis, but this comes out of school practice and fairly current school practice. This list is, I would say, fairly boring, but in terms of what is quite straightforward for teachers to be able to offer to students in terms of supporting translanguaging in your normal everyday academic tasks, things like glossaries or supporting access to sources of information that are in different languages, ways of shaping collaboration in the classroom to make use of shared linguistic resources. Also, how translanguaging can contribute to the way students comprehend or analyse texts as well as the way they produce them. There's a lot of scope here for building in translanguaging pedagogies. And it's not a case of, you know, having to invent new ideas, because there's a lot that can be transferred over from bilingual educational contexts into a more multilingual context. And one of the key worries, I suppose, that teachers might have is, what can I do when I don't speak the languages of those students? Well, I think that the context that I'm in, and this research really shows that this, in a high school in particular, the students don't need the teachers to do everything for them, or even with them, just to provide some frameworks that support what they can do. And this is really important in as they progress in education and in their lives. This one I think is slightly more interesting, because these are some examples of things that we've been able to do in our curriculum to include tasks or topics or activities that use translanguaging purposefully in the classroom. So one example here, of course, is the research project, and you've seen examples of students accessing sources in different languages. But I can also say that we've had students choose language-based topics. So they've included a couple of students who've written or translated children's books in multiple languages, and one student who's produced vocabulary books in Tamil and English for young children. And I will mention here that this student writing in Tamil and English is also part of our adaptive education program. So it sort of shows that translanguaging is something that students of every level, if they have access to other languages, these are skills that they can apply in their learning. So at this particular school, we're lucky enough to have formal EAL classes from year 8 to year 12. And in all of these year levels, I guess gradually over time, we've managed to incorporate some level of translanguaging into different topics and tasks. So students, usually it's optional, and because students have very different levels of resourcing in their languages, but students have the option of applying translingual skills in their personal writing and speaking, based around cultural topics, some production of dual language texts, which include like instructional texts that parents can use to engage with school processes. And of course in the language research that we've seen some results of. And then even in SACE we've found some scope to include options for translanguaging. Stage 1 and Stage 2 courses have language analysis tasks, so we give students the option to include a home language text alongside an English language text that they're analysing. So for example, in Year 11 the students might look at an advertisement for a product in English and an advertisement for a similar product in a language that they know well. The same goes when they analyse songs. And then in the Stage 2 course, we've got a version of Essential English, which we're calling Essential EAL, where the external task is actually a language study. So my good colleague Rita, has supported students in conducting analysis of linguistic landscape in their communities, and that of course involves looking at translanguaging in text and in the physical place. But there's also, I think the students are about to start some analysis which might include their online messaging, incorporating translanguaging, but also sort of transmodal communication. And then there's creative texts, which students will be producing in stage two, as well as some students have incorporated home language sources in their research tasks. So I think there's a lot of opportunity for translanguaging in the existing curriculum. It takes a certain amount of, I guess, risk-taking on the part of the teacher, and we don't know how it's going to play out when it comes to, say, moderation and marking, but we're always optimistic. Things have worked out really well in research projects for those students who have included that translanguaging, so I think that's something really positive. So we're back to where we started. I had a lot of questions that I asked. I don't know whether I answered them, but I wonder if you have any questions or comments. There's fairly limited time, but I'd appreciate anything.
We definitely have time for questions, but oh, that's good. All we need to thank you.
Okay.